Hi, I'm Bob Hancock. Sorry, it's taking a little time to get this set up. How many people here, just to warn you, it's going to be in English. But I see that Luciano was here, who's become my de facto translator of Portuguese. I want to just let everybody know, when I start talking rather quickly. If I start talking too quickly, just raise your hand and do that, slow down. Also, if there's anything that I say that's not clear, please raise your hand, because I don't want anybody to get lost in what we're talking about. What I'm going to talk about, I gave a tutorial yesterday, which was about 4 hours long, on Python scaling with concurrency and parallelism. And instead of shortening it, I'm going to give you the highlights of what we had there. But if you have questions at any point, I want you to raise your hands. I want you to be able to get something out of this. Now, so, how many people here program at least part-time in another language besides Python? How many would say they're comfortable with C, C++? How many would say they're comfortable with Java? How many people like Java? Just asking. How many people have used Go? How many people do not know what Go is? And don't be embarrassed, I wouldn't expect you to. So it looks like the majority of you have at least played with it. Just one second while I open the editor and we'll hook it right up. Okay, can everyone, oh, this is great. Okay. I'm not tied to the microphone. So, my name is Bob Hancock. I'm not sure if John will probably give you a short address. I run a small consulting company in New York City. In the past couple of years, I've been obsessed with the idea of scaling performance. What do we do to make things faster when they get bigger? Now, Python is the 18th language that I've programmed in. I really like it. But there are some problems, and we're going to talk about that today and how you can deal with it. So, we all love Python, and that's why I assume that we're here. Now, some of the reasons we love it is it maximizes engineering time. Because every time you do a project, you have to say, how much time am I going to spend in engineering versus what am I going to get for performance on the other side? And we know that Python really maximizes the engineering time as opposed to something like, say, Java, which takes a longer period. For example, to successfully open a socket takes maybe one or two lines to read a web page in Python. It takes between 28 and 39 lines in Java, depending upon how much error checking you want to do. What I like best about Python is it allows us to work on the problem and not on the language itself. It's very clear. If you have a problem that you can frame, the chances are that you can put it into Python code. Also, anyone who's programmed any C-like language can take your code, look at it, and understand it. And one of the things we forget about is that code is read close to 87% of the time as opposed to being executed. One of the great things Guido did was get rid of the semicolons and force us to write our code in a specific way so that everybody's code looks very similar. And Scala and Go have both adopted this. If you take a look at them, I think this is really the wave of the future. But probably the single largest thing which allows us to be really productive with Python is rapid iteration. You've got an idea, you want to try it out, you got to know immediately whether it works or not. I don't know if you've seen the XKCD cartoon where the guys are fighting with swords in the hallway and the boss yells, "What are you doing?" He said, "We're waiting for something to compile." He said, "That's okay, fine." And sometimes, the perfect example was at Google, they had a C++ program that was compiling, and it was taking upwards of 4 hours to do it. So when they went and checked, they found out that there was one header file that had a circular reference and had to be compiled 37,000 times before the compilation could proceed. We have nothing like that in Python. We have tremendous library support. I don't know of any other language which has support for Python. If you want to do something, the chances are very good that somebody else has done it or has done part of it, and you can just add it in. And I think sometimes we forget how cooperative the Python community is, because if you only come to Python conventions, you have a very slanted view of the world. I've gone to other language conventions, I don't think I'll name them, some of them are just, it's like having a war. But in Python, it's very cooperative. If you have a question, you can ask somebody else, they're willing to help you. And that's a huge plus for our community. And if you're not taking advantage of it, you're a bad person and you're limiting yourself. And we have great documentation. Does anybody here use Ruby? Ruby has a lot of pluses to it. Rails is great. It's easy to put up a website for it. Have you ever had to try to dig in for something in the Ruby documentation? It's like going on safari in a foreign country. So there are all those pluses. But since we're all Python programmers, let's talk like we're in the family and be serious about what some of the problems are. It can be slow compared to Java, C++, or Go. We're sacrificing some speed because we're getting all the things we talked about before. One of these, speed can be affected by how you write your code. That was what most of my tutorial was about yesterday. You really, just by the way that you program something in Python, you can make an enormous effect on the execution time. Now, that's not true with some of the compiled languages, because you can write really bad code, and a compiler will optimize it for you. But one of the things Guido talked about when writing the language was, he wanted it to be like C. He wanted to be able to trust the programmer. Now, I use the analogy between different languages about what you get for cars. Java is like the family station wagon. Put the kids in it, you're not going to go too fast. If you crash into something, nobody's really going to get hurt. If you're using C, and I'm not saying C++, you're just using C, that's like driving a Maserati. You can go really fast if you want to, and you can be really stupid and crash. And if the car breaks, it's going to take you a long time to find a mechanic that can really fix it. Python's something like a BMW, that if you want to go fast, you can. And we're going to trust you not to be too stupid, but if you do crash, you might wreck the car, but you're probably going to be okay. So we're somewhere in the middle there. Now, some of the things to think about is, like, instantiating a class in Python is really expensive. Guido had a post that he put up on his blog not too long ago saying you should really need to think about when you need a class. We don't want to become a language like Java, and I don't mean to beat on Java, but I don't consider Java object-oriented. I consider it object-obsessed. Everything has to be an object, whether you need it or not. Think about whether you really need an object, or you can get it by doing several procedures, because every time that you instantiate an object, you're not only invoking an expensive process, you're creating a very large namespace, and you also have to implement a lot of parts of it that you don't necessarily need. Now, there are ways of getting around that, but you're breaking a lot of the advantages of the language. So really think whether you need a class or not. One of the things, if we run this, you can only catch some errors at runtime. I had one application that I tested like you wouldn't believe, and it failed at 2 a.m. in the morning. And of course, I got called for it. There is at Google a new project where you can take surveys online. Brett Slotkin, who's a big Python advocate, used to work on AppEngine, is working on it. And they have created a process where they do testing, and now they have a separate program. They haven't decided whether to open source it, which then performs a series of automated tests on Python. And these are some smart Python guys, and they say with virtually everything before it goes to production, they're catching problems. It's much more than Python, and I'm hoping that we see that in the future. However, if someone wants to start working on it, that would be a great idea. There's no standard for asynchronous I/O, and we'll get to that toward in a couple of slides, because that's probably one of the biggest things with Python. Yeah. Does that sound better? Another a problem which is not a problem and is a problem is great not to have a corporate sponsor because you don't have somebody to sue telling you what you can do. The other problem is who steers it? It's like crowdsourcing. I still can't believe that we're in 2012 and Python packaging sucks. It's really bad. Everybody agrees that it's bad, but no one's taken the bull by the horn and tried to steer it. Same thing with asynchronous I/O. Why do we still have that? Why do we have the problems with the guild? So there's one of the problems with not having a corporate sponsor. You don't have someone putting engineering time behind it to solve specific problems. And the guild. This is probably the biggest bone of contention on the Python community. Is it good? Is it bad? Are you indifferent? A man named Dave Beasley, and if you don't know who he is, you need to know who he is. He's one of the smartest and most diabolical minds in the Python community. He is agnostic about the GIL. Because, what's the plus part of the GIL? Python is extensible. If you don't like something, you can write something in C. Or if you have something that's already written in C, you can just link to that library. Or even now, there is a way that someone has written, if you search on the internet, of taking Go and calling Go from Python. So that's really great. I've got a little limitation of the language. I can easily use something from C. The bad part is that the GIL takes over everything. So if you're using a thread, no other thread can execute it unless you're holding that GIL. That means you have to wait for it to finish. Meanwhile, you've got the interpreter saying, can I have it? Can I have it? Can I have it? Which my analogy is when you're driving your kids somewhere and they're sitting in the back seat and they're saying, Dad, are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? You're not going to turn around and slap your child. You can't slap the GIL. You just got to put up with it.
You can't slap the GIL.
So that's the bad part of it. But there are ways when, if you understand how it works, that you can use that to your advantage. Now here's something using the right idiom. This is a slide from my tutorial yesterday. I took a base case of a 60 gigabyte web log. And you need to look through it to find each record that's owned by the user SSBRTG. So we went through different ways that you could do it. And this is the synopsis. That the worst was using, that's right, was chunking up the file, which seems to be a good idea, sort of like MapReduce. I've got a big one, oh, I can have four deterministic processes at the same time. And I'm going to use futures. Now here's a word thrown around a lot, futures and promises. Someone want to take a stab at what futures and promises are? Speak up.
Microphone.
Yeah, but that, what are they? Right, that means you make a request now, and sometime in the future, God knows when, it will be fulfilled for you. Now that sounds like a pretty good idea. However, the big bar on the x-axis of this are the implementations, the y-axis are the seconds that it took to complete. So, using Python 2, it was 2.7 in this case, chunking it up and using futures, which sounds like a really good idea, you get the big bar. However, in Python 3, this was 3.2.2, so it's even got the larger Unicode chunks that it has to deal with, I put it into a pipeline. Now, a pipeline, I'm sure most of you know, is like in Unix. They were the people that invented it. When you have the vertical bar like that, it's called a pipe. Because you're taking the output from one program and piping it into another one. And you can do that in Python too. We don't have time to discuss the details, but when GitHub stops gagging on me, I think that's with my Wi-Fi connection, you can go up and there's tons of code on there that will show you how to do it from my tutorial yesterday. It's open and free to everyone. But a pipeline works on the premise, and you really should think about this when you're designing things, that the output for any program or any procedure should be able to be used as the input for another. Now think about that. That's true. Virtually anything in Unix you can pipe into something else. And if you did that or a little orthogonal things in Python, you could just start putting stuff together in pipelines as coroutines. Don't be scared of the word. We're going to talk about that a little bit too. Now, since we're talking about scale, this is a general principle of scale. Everything that you do is compounded at scale. If you make a good decision, you're going to reap all the benefits when it's at scale. If you make a really bad decision, you're going to shoot yourself in the foot. If you make something which is less than optimal, it's going to do this, the bigger that you get. So get into the habit of, even when you're writing small programs, understand what you're doing and think about that it's going to be a scale of what would happen. So the way to do this is to test even more than you're doing now. How many people think they test their programs enough before releasing them? Okay, that's a realistic way. Like one or two people, okay, yeah, I think so, maybe, kind of. Most people don't test enough. They don't test edge cases. We've got a perfectly good testing framework in Python. It astounds me that there's actually the 15th largest website in the world, which I won't name, it's the most frequently. I was talking to them 2 weeks ago. I found out that when they release code, they don't test it before they release it. They put it on one server after another and see how many people complain. That's pretty much the testing. Yeah, it scared me too. Test edge cases. Edge cases will really kill you at scale. I have another project which is clustering of unstructured data. Now, one of the cases we came up against that we tested for that intellectually we couldn't imagine is when you're clustering unstructured data, you have lots of points, and you pick certain centroids, and you say, pair each point, which is with the closest centroid. So all my points over here are going to be with this centroid, all the ones over here are with this one. Now, then you say, how good is my clustering? You tend to look statistically, what is the variance? And then we plug it into a log likelihood. That gives us a very nice result. However, what if you have points here, and there's one over here, and you've got one centroid, which is that point over there. What's the variance on something when you have two things and they're exactly the same? It's zero. And if you plug zero into a log likelihood, you're going to go to infinity. Okay? So we could have done everything right, and that one thing blew up the entire program. Fortunately, I had a test for it before we showed it to them. The thing about things like this, so test even more, because large things, it's just going to blow up on you. And then, this is from Rob Pike. Someone else, if you don't know, that you should know, he writes things which are remarkably clear and very complex subjects. Rob worked at Bell Labs for years. He worked on Unix, the first iteration after Ken Thompson had done it. He and Ken Thompson got tired one time of dealing with foreign characters, so they sat down and invented UTF-8. Rob's also the major architect of the Go language, which is the fourth language that he has written. The fourth complete language that he has written. But he says you need to measure and then measure again. Because as human beings, we're all optimistic. We all think, oh, well, that seemed fast. It must be fast. And we tend to fool ourselves because we have confirmation bias. And even if you measure one thing, you can't be aware of everything that's going to affect it. So if you have something, run it X number of times and then take your mean of it. And once you think you've got it, measure it again at a different time or under different circumstances. Another good example in my other project too, it has a lot of calculations in it. And we found out that when the mantissa of a floating point exceeded 5 places, it got incredibly slow. And that didn't make any sense because it should be proportional. But it turns out the machine that we were on has a shared coprocessor, has a shared processor for floating point. So once once it got to a certain point, you ended up with something different. I'm not that concerned about hardware. So somebody mentioned to me, put it on another one and it flew like lightning. But that's a test that we put in now for floating point and everything to check whether it has a coprocessor. So you need to know what things cost. What does disk access cost? What's more expensive, disk access or network access? Somebody take a guess. How many say disk access is more expensive than network? Okay. How many say network is more expensive than disk? How many people won't vote? Yeah, at least you did see one vote. Okay. Well, it varies. But when you're designing, you have to assume that networks are going to be slower because the possibility for latency, statistically, is more likely with a network connection. Because if you throw something out to a network, how do you know what the path is? So the possibility for it costing much more, always assume that network access is going to be much more expensive unless you're on a closed network where you control all the routing. Context switch. Now we're getting down to how the operating system does things. Context switch is what happens when I have a thread or a process running and says, well, maybe I'm going to block or do something else. And the operating system says, well, I'm going to move you into a wait state. I'll let this guy do something, and then I'll move you back. And on that level, it sounds really easy. What's the big deal? What you'll see is going on under the hood is the equivalent of you working in an office in a cubicle, and someone comes up and says, you don't look like you're doing anything. Can I use that? So you have to take a picture of everything in your cube. You have to save all your files. You have to pick it up. You have to move your cube. The other person has to move in, set it up, do their task. Then they have to take a picture of everything, bring it down, save their files, move back. Then you have to move back in. And you have to set everything back up. And you have to start working exactly where you left off. That's what the operating system is doing. So the context switch is the single most expensive. It's even more expensive than a fork in most cases. So you have to be aware when that's going to happen. And talk a little bit about where that does happen. I already talked about instantiating a class. And forking a process is expensive. Someone want to tell me the difference between a process and a thread? Okay, whether you want to or not, who can tell me the difference between a process and a thread? Oh, come on, don't be shy. Now you were in the tutorial yesterday, it doesn't count. That's an aspect of it. What's the difference between a process and a thread? What is a process and what is a thread and how do they differ? Everything everybody's saying is true. The major point that I want to see is what's the hierarchy between the two? Are they equal? That's a cost, isn't it? What's the hierarchy? What I'm getting at is that the thread has to exist inside of a process. Okay? You can have multiple threads. Now, threads came from, they're originally called lightweight processes. They're from Plan 9, which is another Bob Pike and Thompson project. So, forking a task, as they say in Linux, or a process is pretty expensive. The operating system has to allocate namespace, it has to give it a process ID, etc. Then you're saying, well, I've already got this stuff. I want to make a lightweight in between so I can share this memory between the threads, which you should never do. Sharing memory is really bad. You should communicate to share memory, not share memory to communicate. Not every language makes it easy. If you're going to do it in Python, use a synchronized priority queue. It's the simple, easiest way to do it. Some people try to, if you start using the Unix pipes, which are available in the OS, it gets to be really, really complicated. So use a priority queue, but don't share variables in memory and start putting in mutexes. You will slow yourself down when it starts playing. And they're doing that all with Python. YouTube was written in Python. And most of it's still. However, they are running into problems and all the new parts are being written in Go. Do you guys use Quora down here? you haven't looked at it, take a look at it. Quora.com. It's a site where you can ask questions and people will come in and give answers. They've written the entire thing in Python. And they're also probably the single largest users of PyPy. Because in that particular case, PyPy works for them. Here's a caution. PyPy is not the salvation, neither is Python 2. Python 3 is probably the closest that you're going to get to it. Python 3.3, how many people use some version of Python 3 as their standard Python? We've got these two little islands, one here and one over there. Okay. Because it doesn't have the library support, everybody's used to 2.7. 3.3 is a major improvement. And if you look, when you get the slides from my tutorial, you'll see that in almost all cases, Python 3 is the fastest. So start thinking about it, particularly in 3.3 when they get rid of the big UTF problem where everything had to be 2 or 4 bytes depending upon how it was compiled upon your system, and now it stores it only for the number of bytes that are required. Now, this is one of my biggest pet peeves. Around 1998, I remember we had programmers who were engineers. And then after that, the next years, we started to get developers. Developers were people that said, I don't care how it works, I just want to put this application together. You know what, if it's not fast enough, in another year there'll be a faster machine and memory will be cheaper, so I don't have to worry about how I program, so I will just do that. And then 2006, 2007, we reached the physical limit and we started getting multi-cores on machines. And I said, well, that's really easy, I'll just throw stuff on an individual core. And everybody got used to more and more speed with people like Amazon and Google, and suddenly the machines weren't getting faster and the developer code was getting slower and slower. So if you really want to program at scale, you have to be an engineer. You have to understand how things work underneath. Here's a question that I asked yesterday. What is multiprocessing? Everybody assumes we have multiprocessing operating systems today. It's just standard. What is it? What does that mean? Multiple things at the same time? Speak louder. Kind of. How many things can the operating system execute simultaneously? Go ahead. How many?
One.
So, you only have one kernel. You can have 64 cores, like with some of the Sun machines. You have one kernel, and it only can execute one thing at a time. So from that means everything is executed sequentially. So if you have a sequence, and this one guy here is CPU bound, what happens to all the guys that are waiting in line, even if you have 64 cores? He's going to wait. So you need to know what's CPU bound, what's IO bound, how to separate them, and when to spot them. And in order to do that, you have to understand something about how the operating system works. So that's where you become an engineer and not a developer. If you're a Python engineer, you need to understand generators. What's a generator? Is it an object? Is it a procedure? Is it a function? Is it a method? Is it what? Somebody take a guess. That's true, but is it an object? Is it a procedure? Because, I mean, we write them as procedures, right? But the procedure is not the generator, because the procedure returns a generator object. The important part of the generator is that it saves state. Okay? Now, when you write a regular procedure, you're going to have a return state, or I should say a function, because a procedure can be something that doesn't return. A function will always return something. So you have a function, and once you hit return, you return a value, that means it's popping it off the stack and it's moving everything out, because it's returned and it's finished. A generator is going to stick around, and you're going to say, oh, give me, and you say next, and it, if you're incrementing numbers, and it got one, it's going to give you two the next time if you wrote it the right way. It saves state in between. Now, one of the little secrets of generators is that they can be incredibly efficient. Because if you have a generator object that's saving state, this is how much memory it's taking up. If you're using a for loop for iteration, Python really wants to make stuff easy for you. So it's going to, if you're reading from a file, it's going to read a big chunk before, and it's going to keep chunking up for you, because it's trying to make life easy for you. But that's memory allocation, that's memory deallocation, that's memory that you're taking up. What if it's not contiguous? What if there's a context switch in the middle of it? With a generator, bang, it's just this little call. If you have any iteration which is of any sort of size, and I would say over 100, think very carefully whether you need a generator. And one of the great things about generators is its output that you can keep getting with each call. And that starts to give you the idea of a pipeline. One at a time, something is passed down. So if you have a whole string of generators, they're all taking up this amount of memory, as opposed to, oh, here's a procedure, let me call back, take that process in a loop. Get an ongoing pipeline. Generators are your friend. If you need speed and you need to scale, understand generators. And if you're really adventurous, look at Python 3.3, because there are sub-generators, which is something we want. It's like talking about annotations. It gets to be like a religious discussion, so we're going to avoid that for right now. Now, coroutines. Coroutines are going to be very important for asynchronous I/O. What is a coroutine? Okay. How long have coroutines been around?
6 years.
Since when? Give me a year. 1958 is the first mention. Peter Portante, who wrote the threading library for HPV Unix, so we communicate back and forth, and he actually owns the entire Donald Knuth Art of Programming library, which he actually says he either uses to hold up his monitor for a doorstop. But he combed through it, and there's a reference from 1958 where Conway and Knuth were sketching out, what are we going to do? Because we have these new machines that are computers. But I said, how about this idea that something saves state and you put stuff in and it comes back out? And that's when coroutines were invented. In 1964, there's a paper by Conway on coroutines. And then, it's like the entire world forgot about them. And threads came up in Plan 9, and they were easy to implement, and they took over. And everybody forgot about coroutines. However, if you want to see a return on Google search that's probably the largest type in, why doesn't Java have coroutines? People have been asking that since 1999. So a coroutine is like a generator, except instead of saying next, where it emits a value for you, you send data to a coroutine, it does something, and then it emits a value. But when it emits the value, it doesn't necessarily have to return. You can execute the equivalent of a go-to within a coroutine. So you can go from one coroutine to another coroutine. You don't necessarily have to turn back to them. So you have this being, it's like it's part of a pipeline. It takes something in and it emits something. And I'll show you two or three projects that are using it. And again, look at, that's a fairly complicated subject. But if you want to get to scale, you can start plugging things together that aren't just generators for next. You're sending stuff, you're putting it out, it's in the language, it's fast, and your memory imprint is that large. Okay? Blocking work versus non-blocking I/O. Understand what that is, who uses it, and we'll talk about some of the people that use it. Now, blocking I/O is what every modern operating system does for you. If you make a system call and say, I want 1 megabyte of data, and it's going to take a while to get it because it may be from the network or from a disk, your operating system will automatically say, okay, I'm going to put you into the wait while I fill the buffer until I can fulfill it, then I'll bring you back in and I'll let you read from that buffer. Non-blocking I/O is, your buffer isn't full, but whatever I've got from the device, I'm going to throw at you at the moment, and it's up to you to deal with it. So that's a lot faster because you don't have the operating system moving you in and out and blocking and waiting till the buffer is full. However, it puts the onus on you to handle it. So G-Event is probably the best one for handling. We'll talk about that in a second. Talk about processes and threads. Understand when the gill is a problem. If I have something which is I/O bound and it's slow, and I have four processors on my machine, which doesn't actually, yeah, let's say we have four processors, that's very common on a laptop now. Say, well, why don't I divide it up and make four deterministic processes at the same time? You know how slow that's going to make it for you? Because the gill has the kid in the back seat talking. That's when it's not going to work for you. If you have a lot of I.O. where you know it's going to be a network call, your network is slow, or it's going to take a long time to come back, that's the perfect place. The gill will be your friend in that case. But you have to understand your application, because you can just kill yourself if you don't understand the gill. If you want to know how the gill really works, go to Dave Beasley's site. You just look for Dave Beasley on the internet. And he has an entire presentation that he did on the gill and the new gill that Antoine Petrou wrote. So if you're in the 3 series, you'll see it. And it will give you the details. And that will allow you to make a decision in the design phase, so you don't have to wait till you're testing. Understand which version of Python is best for you. 3, 2.7, PyPy. They all behave differently. Understand them. Embrace gevent. Gevent does what Node.js does. It does formally what Erlang does. It does what Go does. So, process, thread in between. If I switch from thread to thread, does the operating system know that I switched between threads? How many yes? How many no? How many of you going, I've never had to think about that? Threads, even though they're subservient to processes, are the smallest level that the operating system can schedule and switch in and out. So if you switch from thread to thread, you're still asking for a context switch. So what gevent and Erlang and Node.js does, apart from the whole concept of callbacks, is they say, here's a thread or a process. I'm going to create my own stack in here, and I'm going to have an effect. It's basically a stack. I'll pop stuff up. I put something in. I'll pop it off. Actually, it's a queue. Sorry. It's not a stack. So it will pop it off, and I won't tell the operating system about it. Because if the operating system doesn't know that I'm doing this, I don't get a context switch. I don't get put into a wait state. And guess what? I can do them on multiple CPUs, because if I'm not telling the operating system, I can do everything that I want on one CPU and then collect everything together. It's kind of scary how it works. The guys know what they're doing. But if you're using Python, gevent is getting better and better. And most of the funding for it now comes from Spotify, because that's what they use very heavily to run their back end. So if you want to get speed, learn how gevent works. Futures and promises. Look at futures and promises using the threading model and not the multiprocessing model, both 2.7 and 3. It's astounding how much speed if you've got something and you just put them into futures and you have processes. Again, look at my files, you'll see examples of it. And it astounds me how many people don't use them. And how many people have read PEP 380? Oh, I'm sure everybody has. We got so many now. This is, at that URL, the results of that. This is Guido's request to have a standard way of doing asynchronous I.O. in Python. He's working on the project. He's looking for people to look over the code. He's looking for your comments. So if you want it, download it, look at it. If you want to know how to use coroutines to do asynchronous I.O., this is exemplary code. The idea is that once we get it running, we can fold it into, say, Python 3. Something or other, and this will be the standard way of doing asynchronous I.O. Also, look for posts by smart people. And these are 3 people I really like to follow. We all know Guido. Dave Beasley, as I said, is the most diabolical mind in the Python community. This guy can explain anything. And he is working on the Python cookbook for Python 3. It was due last December, but you know, he has 2 kids under 4 years old. He's running a business. I told him before I came down here, I said, I'm going to recommend to everybody in Python Brazil that they buy your book when it comes out. And I said, it better be good. He said, well, it has to be finished before I know whether it's good or not. But this will be a collection of idiomatic things that you can do in Python, and a lot of it will have to do with the performance. Peter Portante. Peter has a talk from PyCon 2 years ago where he talks about coroutines and how they work. It's the best explanation I've ever seen of it. He now works for Red Hat as an engineer. Super smart guy. Look for anything. But he also has, I forget what it's called now, but if you look at it on the Python site, if you have your Python code, you can load this in and you can see the entire abstract base tree of how your Python code is put together, graphically shown out for you. Now, this is the part where I come and I use my keynote as a bully pulpit to try to convince you. What can you do? This is tackle big problems. Don't look at the small things. You're all engineers. You've had the benefits of education. You have Python, you have all this stuff for free. Think about, if anybody's been, I've been programming for 20 years now. So I remember when stuff wasn't free, when you had to buy things. And now most we argue about is patents. But people don't seem to look at the big ideas. There's a story, and I wanted to know whether it's true. I get to meet Ken Thompson in June. Ken Thompson is basically the guy who invented Unix at Bell Labs. Now, there was a Voltex program between MIT and Bell Labs and General Electric, and it fell apart. It was going to be, in the late 60s, a multi-processing operating system. Get that? None of this stuff, one thing is done at a time on a tape drive. But, of course, they argued MIT wanted to use only Lisp and create a Lisp machine. The other guys thought that was crazy. General Electric wanted to use their own operating system. So they broke off, and Ken went back to Bell Labs and didn't have anything to do. And they didn't have a project for him yet, and they said, maybe, you know, do something. So there was the PDP-7 sitting there, which was an early DEC machine, single processor machine. So Ken invented a game where he visited individual planets. Okay? Obviously very crude in 1969, but in 1969, each time he played it, it cost $75 in 1969 dollars in computing time. So he was doing this numerous times per day, and finally his bosses came over and said, this is the wrong thing for you to be working on. They said, well, do you have a project for me yet? I said, no, okay, but you can't keep doing this. So instead of stopping it, he said, you know, if I wrote a better file system, I bet it wouldn't cost as much. So he wrote a file system, and he said, well, you know, it works okay. He said, what I really need is an operating system that can handle this file system. So he started writing an operating system in assembly. He said, you know, this is getting really boring, writing this in assembly. I said, well, I need a language. And they said, well, this guy over here has been working on some stuff, and it's like level B. And he took it over, and he worked it, and that became C. And then they started writing Unix. And that's how Unix came up, because his game was costing too much. So he didn't say, well, I'm going to stop, or I'm going to look to see what somebody else has done. I'll write a file system. I'll write an operating system. Because what's the worst that could happen? That's a big problem. It's like when he and Rob were looking at UTF-8. I'm sick of having to deal with all this stuff. Oh, well, why don't we create a way to do it? And they did the same thing with Go. They were actually sitting around a lunch table and said, I like this from Python. I like this from C. If I could do this again, I would do this. So they said, well, why don't we write our own language? And they said, well, we need a compiler for it. And Ken said, well, I think, you know, I've got time on the weekends, so I can have one in the next month. So he wrote a compiler for them in 4 times because he wasn't scared or deterred by it. Okay, so think big. For example, why is it 2012 and we still have a monolithic kernel? We're still doing one thing at a time. We have machines, some which have hundreds of cores on them, and we're still doing everything one at a time. And to make it faster, we're now sharding the Unix kernel in different parts of memory, so we're trying not to access all of it at once. You can download the kernel code. If you have an idea, start playing with it. Google uses their own kernel. It's still monolithic, but very quickly, talk about performance. When you do a Google search, okay, you type in something, three processes are started on the Google infrastructure, two of which are guaranteed to be geographically diverse. Now, I wondered how they get all this stuff back very quickly, and I was talking to Ryan Barrett when I was out in California, and it turns out they've changed the kernel that they read in 64 megabyte chunks. And before they write it into a 64 megabyte chunk, they make sure the data is sorted and contiguous, and when they write it, in a meta table, they keep what machine, what disk, what sector it's in. So every disk read for your Google search is O of one. It's constant time. Okay? So somebody just said, well, you know, maybe we could do this. And someone said, well, you know, it's because the kernel doesn't work, so what do we, well, why don't we only gonna change part of the kernel, that's why not? It's free code. And I would encourage other people to do that. You're all engineers. How do we implement non-blocking IO? Why are we still letting the operating system throw us off for that? And how do we implement sub-thread level coroutines across multiple cores? Right now, it's all within a thread. We're fooling the operating system. But what if I want to talk to something in another thread? I'm not telling the operating system, so how do we do that? I know somebody that's already working on that. The language is in beta. So they've solved the problem. It's just the performance is a problem. Why don't we work on that? We could do that in Python. Why not have a module that would do that for you. And learn from other languages. I was told, somebody told me that pythonbrasil used to have one keynote where somebody talked about a different language. Still do? Great. Because I would encourage everybody, as Go is the 19th language that I've learned, I think I've learned something from every one of them. I probably could use my time better than spending 6 months with Eiffel. Nothing really ever came out of that. But you can learn a lot from other languages. Sometimes we get to be like people in a church. It's Python is a religion, and everything has to be Python, and we can learn a lot from other people. So, here's what not to do. Do not write another web framework. If you have spare time, don't spend your time doing this. God, I mean, we have Django, we have Pyramid if you want an orthogonal system, we have Bottle, we have Flask if you want something that's lightweight. Stop writing web frameworks, okay? And don't be clever. I didn't write it down, but I went to someone's code, and I saw it was a list comprehension. Yes, list comprehensions are nice, but not when you have like 45 tests in a lambda in the middle of it, and it shows across the screen like that. It makes Haskell look like you're reading a newspaper. Don't do that. That's just dumb. Okay? Complicated versus complex. Understand the difference. If something's complicated, like the big problems, there's no way to get around it. You have to attack it as a complicated problem. But don't make it complex by like writing stupid comprehensions. Be simple in what you do. Don't stop reading and searching. I can't tell you how many people I see who, in companies that reinvent the flat tire. Read what people who are smarter than you have done, understand how they came to their conclusions, and keep on top of what they're up to. And I don't mean just reading bland, random blog posts. That's why I said find people that you think are really smart, that you really respect. Find out what they're looking at and what they have done. So, and don't be satisfied with what you're going to say. Ah, it's fast enough. That's good enough. I can always use Python. Well, Larry Page proposed for his PhD that he wanted to index the internet. His advisor said, no, come on, be serious. We haven't got that much time. What do you really want to do? He said, I want to index the internet. And not only that, I want to do it on commodity hardware. I'm like, okay, go away and come back when you've got something. And it was so hard for him to get support at first with that idea that he and Sergey set up in a part of Stanford University, and they couldn't afford PCs. So they went to every department, and they said, listen, we'll make a deal with you. We'll set up your PCs to be just the way you want, but you've got to let us use it for 3 weeks. So they found out who was getting new PCs. They would get them, use them for 3 weeks, make an image of it, then reconfigure it, hand it off to the department, go to the loading dock, and get another one. That's how they started out. That's a big idea. The end result was that neither one of them got their PhDs because their company started going so well they dropped out of school. But everyone was telling them why he couldn't do it. And these are the most important things. Ask questions. I just don't understand why people don't ask more questions. If you don't understand something, ask a question. Willful ignorance takes a lot more energy than just asking a question. I saw Rob Pike and Ken Thompson. In June, they were talking about progress on Go, and someone came up to the microphone in a very contentious way and said, why isn't Go doing this? Why haven't you guys done this by now? This seems obvious. And Rob Pike looked at me and said, might be that we're just not smart enough. And he had no sarcasm whatsoever. He said, just might not be smart enough. You should have talked to him. He said, I'm sorry, what are you talking about? I don't understand. Somebody was talking to Ken Thompson about how a language works. He said, I don't know how that works. Can you explain it to me? This is the guy who invented Unix, has no problem asking a question. An ounce of math is worth a pound of programming, okay? If you're doing anything that's combinatoric, if you have to find permutations, it's nice to be able to call the library and get it, but understand what it is and how it works. Understanding certain elements of math will just save you so much time in the design phase. And work together. Don't sit yourself in a little room. No one has ever created anything by themselves. They look at Ken saying that he created Unix, and he went through, there were seven other people who were working with him, but he got the limelight. Learn to work together and start now. Don't wait, oh, I'm going to do it next month, I'm going to do that. There are enough big problems out there that we could, think about if you could solve some of these problems, what it could do for genetic research. Think about, one thing at Columbia University, where they were using Bayesian analysis with the astrophysics department to look at parts of the Earth, and then they went to another department where they had registered the heat, and they connected them together, so now they have a program which will run on a laptop that can tell in developing countries where the power stations are more likely to be located because they're away from the heat and they can be more easily cooled. So this has saved them, they say, approximately 2 years of planning time and helping make people's lives better, because some people get interested in this idea. So start that now. And if you have suggestions or anything, I'm going to be here for a bit. Come up and talk to me, say hello, introduce yourself, because I spent a lot of time in the United States. I've gone to talk in Europe this year, but it's always, everybody has their own view. You call it the orchid in the hothouse, because orchids can only be grown and they have to be apart from other plants, so you walk into an orchid hothouse and everything looks like an orchid. And you sometimes get like that within your communities. So that would be a favor to me if you guys come up and tell me what you're thinking, where you are, because I've never been in Brazil before or South America. This is my first time. So I'd like to know what you're thinking of doing, what do you see as the problems? And that's pretty much it. So as I said, I'm going to get this up on the line as soon as I can get up to stop gagging. This is the old version of it that I gave at PyCon USA in March, if you want to start looking at the files. They haven't changed that much, but it will give you a good idea of what's going on. And at this point, I have a book here, Programming Computer Vision with Python, which is supposed to, let's see, I'm going to give it to this gentleman, so because he answered three questions without hesitation, and I want to reward people for it. I was told we were supposed to raffle these things off, but they couldn't tell. Ah! We got to do
it. You want to do it now?
We can. Yeah, let's get ready for it to raffle it off. Does anybody have any questions on anything that I have said? I'm going to start from the back because I always start from the front. Go.
An ounce is lighter than a pound.
Yes, it's once. Of course. Yes, an ounce is 1/16 of a pound. So, what should I say? A milligram of math is worth a kilo of programming. That's an even better one, actually. Is there anyone else? Yeah. Speak up. No, I said when you're reading a file, it will try to buffer ahead for you. No. Use the disk and find out, and you'll see exactly what it is. Anyone else?
Repeat the question.
Okay. I'm sorry. We're recording, so I have to repeat the question. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You mentioned subtracts in beta. Beta language, the same one created by Christian Dinger.
Subthreads.
Yeah, you mentioned routines that can go
across. Oh, okay. Yes, that's being done. And the guys who are doing Go are working. And they've got it working, but it's very slow. So when are we going to see it? We don't know, because they released Go 1.2, which got rid of all the bugs, and now they're working on making it faster, redoing how the scheduling is working on Go routines. And to give you an idea how complicated it is, I asked Rob Pike, I said, well, how do you know when you're not writing an operating system on top of an operating system? He said, we are. Anyone else? Going once, twice, okay, you want to get to the good stuff? Okay. I want to see who gets what. Well, he's setting up. I want to actually thank everybody for coming out.